Okay, thank you all. So first of all, this work was a collaboration with Dr. Guy Santana at the University of Leiden, who provided us with very important patient cells. It was led by my postdoc Luca and by another collaborator, Dr. Patrizia Palazzi at Jefferson. It was funded by the Mothers Foundation, and it was published yesterday on Mesh Communications. So I'm very happy to present this. So the BAF complex is one of the main chromatin remodeling complexes in mammals. It's made of several subunits, and the role of this complex is to use ATP to make the chromatin accessible or condensed or repressed, depending on different contexts. And this complex is made of several subunits. As I said, the biggest one is the EDIT1 subunit. We can have two kinds of EDIT1s in the BAF. One is EDIT1A, and the other one is EDIT1B. They're mutually exclusive, so the same complex can only contain one of these two. But in the same cells, you can have both. We are interested in EDIT1A and 1B because they are both very disease relevant. EDIT1A is the commonly mutated gene, epigenetic modifier, let's say, in cancer. And it's mutated, for example, in 60% of ovarian carcinomas. And it's necessary, we know from mouse models, that it's necessary for nuclear transformation. EDIT1B, on the other hand, is not so commonly mutated in cancer, but is one of the top hits in many neurodevelopmental disorders. It's associated with many syndromes, with autism, and so on and so forth. And the EDIT1B mutations in particular are all utterly sufficient because loss of both alleles of EDIT1B is not viable, nor in mouse or in humans. And EDIT1B mutations are associated with different arrays of intellectual disabilities and also with different degrees of craniofacial impairment, craniofacial abnormalities. EDIT1B is the main cause of Coffin Syndrome, which is a neurodevelopmental syndrome in which 80% of the patients have EDIT1B mutations and 10% have EDIT1A mutations. And the syndromes present with, again, different levels of intellectual disability and also clear craniofacial features. So we were particularly interested in the craniofacial features and in the craniofacial development, which is one of the main research areas in my lab. And so in my lab, we like to use induced pluripotent stem cells, or iPSCs, to study developmental processes. And we were able to obtain iPSCs from derived from skin fibroblasts of two different Coffin Syndrome patients with EDIT1B haploinsufficient mutations. And also we have healthy controls. We differentiated them into cranial neurocrest cells. I'm going to use this acronym CNCCs from now on in the presentation. And we performed different genomic and molecular biology and cell biology experiments to understand the consequences of EDIT1B haploinsufficiency to craniofacial development. The two mutations are respectively a nonsense and a frame shift in the two patients. And in both cases, a premature subcodon is introduced that either precedes or disrupts the edit domain, which is the critical domain of these proteins that is needed to bring the whole complex to chromatin. Also, the subcodons are before the nuclear localization signal. So even if by chance the mutated isoform would actually be translated into protein, it couldn't reach the nucleus. So we leverage a protocol developed first by Gianna Wysoka's lab about 10 years ago to make CNCCs out of iPSCs. This protocol goes through an intermediate step where you have neuroectodermal cells, neuroectodermal spheres, that then they're floating into your plate and then they attach to the plate to form CNCCs. And then the CNCCs potentially can be differentiated in all of the possible derivatives, including both the mesenchymal and the ectodermal ones. So we perform our protocol in both our control line and both of our patient lines. Here you can see patient 19 and 26. These are the names of the patients and the control line. And so starting from the control line, so these are flow cytometry surface markers for neurocrest formation. You can see in red, you have the iPSCs. In blue, you have this intermediate neuroectodermal stage that recapitulates what we see in the Wysoka's paper here. So we see the intermediate stage, and then we see a nice and compact population after 2 weeks. So the entire differentiation takes about 2 weeks, in which you have a nice and compact population of differentiated CNCCs. So 2 weeks for the CNCCs, about a week for the neuroectodermal intermediate. But when you look at the patients, you can already see that something is wrong, because both the neuroectoderma stage and especially the CSCC stage, they're not really where you're expected to be, and they're not really as compact. There's sort of a heterogeneous continuum of cells that goes from the IQC to the CNCC. And when we use flow cytometry to, when we use IF, immunofluorescence, to check some of the neurofluorescence markers, such as SOX9, and some of the pluripotency markers that you all know, such as OCT4 and NANOG, and we check both our control line and patient lines, and this is after 2 weeks, okay? This is day 14, when you're supposed to have fully formed CNCCs, no longer pluripotent-like cells. You can see that, you know, all of our cells express SOX9 as expected, so both the control line and the patient line. But the patient lines, they also are apparently still expressing NANOG in both cases, and in one of the two patients also OCT4. So there seems to be an issue with exit from pluripotency. So our cells, while they do express SOX9 as expected, they also still express also pluripotency markers. And so patient cells, even if they do not, you know, at the IPC stage, I couldn't show you for lack of time, but they show, you know, normal growth, normal proliferation. But then when you differentiate them, they exhibit per CNCC formation. And so we wanted to see what are the molecular basis of this impairment throughout genomics, which is something we do in the lab. And so we have our two control lines, and we compare them with two patient lines, including both sexes. And we needed to choose the time point to collect the cells for the experiments. So we performed a edit 1B time course along CNCC formation. So, you know, it's about 2 weeks. And we see that edit 1B seems to be mostly active in terms of as a protein, mostly in the first week. So in this neurosphere, neuroectoderm intermediate, and then it gets downregulated when the neuroectoderma spheres attach to the cells to form CNCCs. Suggested that IL-1B really seems important for this stage here, the blue one, the neuroectoderm formation, and not really for the next step. And we will see why is that. And so we performed, so IL-1B is part of BAF. And BAF, as I said, is a chromatin remodeling complex. So the first experiment we performed was ATAC-seq, which is a genomic assay that allows you to profile genome-wide thousands of region accessible chromatin. Whenever you see a peak, it's a region of accessible open chromatin. And so we performed the experiment with our control and patient lines. We performed the peak calling, and we identified approximately 30,000 regions that both in patients and control were consistently accessible with no changes. But then we also found approximately 5,500 regions here. You can see that are only accessible in the patients, meaning that we have peaks in all of the patient replicates. And we have never peaks in these regions in none of the control replicates. So these are patient-specific chromatin-accessible regions. Whereas we only found 500 control-specific accessible regions. And so this suggests that mostly the impairment that we see is because you have approximately 5,000 regions that during your neuroectoderm sensitification are aberrantly open, aberrantly accessible. And so we wanted to, first of all, see if RID1B containing BAF, so if RID1B protein actually binds to this region at this time point at day 5. So we performed CHIP-seq in our two control lines and patient lines, and we saw that RID1B clearly binds at all of these regions. These are CHIP-seq heat maps. You imagine every line here is one of these 5,000 regions, and the stronger is the signal here, the stronger is the intensity of binding, the stronger is the CHIP-seq. And so you can see that RID1B is clearly binding in normal conditions, but as expected, since you have no protein, the binding is lost in both of the patient cells. And so we said, okay, RID1B is directly regulating these regions, and when you lose it, these regions remain apparently active, suggesting that RID1B might function as sort of a repressor of these regions when you induce the CNCC formation. So we tried to characterize these regions a little more. We saw that almost 90% of them are distal at least 1 kb from the closest gene, suggesting that these are probably enhancers. And we saw, based on this histone modification, histone marker that normally labels active regulatory regions, H3, K27 acetylation, that these regions are normally, this is a control line, that it won't be wild type. So in normal condition, these regions are very active at the IPC stage. And then as soon as you induce differentiation, they gradually lose their activity. And by day five, there's little to no regulatory activity, suggesting that these regions normally need to be repressed when you induce the differentiation, and that this repression increases when you increase the RIP1B protein level. Again, suggesting that RIP1B might repress approximately 5,000 sites in the genome when you induce IPC to CNCC differentiation, and specifically during the first 5 days, which is your neuroectoderm specification stage. Now, I had no time to show this, but I can tell you that in both of the patient lines, this shutdown doesn't happen, and this mark here is still nice and active up to at least day 9 or 10. So really, there is an impairment in the repression of these enhancers. And since these enhancers were active at the IPC stage, we surmised they could be pluripotent enhancers. And in fact, we see when we perform a motif analysis on these regions, we find enrichment for classic pluripotency markers such as SOX2, SOX3, and especially NANOG. And you will see how this is important later on. So we have 5,000 pluripotency enhancers that are aberrantly active during neuroectoderm classification in the process of forming CNCCs. And so we said this is probably going to affect the entire transcriptome of these cells. So we performed RNA-seq at the day 5, and we found approximately 2,400 differentially expressed genes when you compare the patient with the control lines. And RIP1B, as expected, is one of the top down-regulated ones, and that was comforting to us. And so we asked, of these 2,400 genes, how many are actually near to these 5,000 enhancers that are apparently active? And we found that 600 of them, so a quarter of these differentially expressed genes, actually are the nearest gene to one of these enhancers, suggesting that there is a direct regulation of enhancer by RIP1B, and when the enhancer activity is impaired, the nearby gene expression is affected. And most of these genes that are near RIP1B regulated enhancers are upregulated because expected, right? Because you are keeping these enhancers active, and so the near genes are also active improperly. We performed some pathway analysis on these genes, and we found two different main categories involved. In red, you can see genes involved with pluripotency maintenance, so embryonic stem cell pluripotency and NANOG related networks. Then in blue, we find retinoic acid-related genes and PPAR-alpha pathway-related genes that are all involved with exit from pluripotency. So we have pluripotency-related genes and genes that are important to exit pluripotency and commit towards certain lineages. And when we look at the patterns here, we see that so in the top part of the heat map, we see the pluripotency-related genes, including SOX2, OCT4, and NANOG. And we see that these genes in the patients are all aberrantly upregulated. In the bottom part, we have the exit from pluripotency genes that instead in our patients are all downregulated, suggesting that you really have an upregulation of pluripotency and a downregulation of pathways important to exit pluripotency. So exit from pluripotency is impaired by RIP1B insufficiency. And so what's the mechanism in the context of BAF? So BAF is a big complex with many subunits that, again, can include either RIP1A or 1B, but not both of them at the same time. And this is an important point because a recent paper recently shown that RIP1A containing BAF complexes and RIP1B containing BAF complexes have actually different functions. So while RIP1A containing BAF is usually an activator of transcription, RIP1B BAF is instead usually a repressor. And this is consistent with what we see, that when you lose RIP1B, you actually have missed repression and impaired, you keep these enhancers aberrantly active. And so we wanted to see if we have some, when in our patient cells, if by chance we have some compensations of RIP1B loss by RIP1A upregulation. And so first we characterized RIP1A, we profiled RIP1A activity during CNCC formation in normal conditions, so in a control line cell. So RIP1B is wild type here. And what we see is that RIP1A, remarkably, has the protein levels are complementary to RIP1B. So we showed before that RIP1B gets upregulated and is the most active during the first week during neuroectoderm specification. And you see that instead RIP1A disappears during this stage. And then when IL-1B gets downregulated, when your neurospheres attached to the plate, they start making CNCCs, that's when IL-1B goes away and IL-1A shows up again. So there seems to be really a developmental stage specific activity of these two paradoxes. So you either have one or the other, depending on which stages are you in. But that's in normal conditions. But what happens to the patients that do not have ARID1B? Look what happens. They keep ARID1A always on, always active. So instead of, you know, setting up your complex with ARID1B that is supposed to repress your enhancers, you're keeping a complex that is mostly an activator. And so we surmise that this is probably why the ARID1A containing complex is the ARID1A containing complex is keeping this enhancer active, and so this is probably why these enhancers are still active after these many days. So we checked that by ChIP-seq, is ARID1A actually binding in there at these enhancers improperly? And so, as a reminder, in normal conditions at your day five, these pluripotency enhancers are supposed to be bound by ARID1B. But instead, in your patient cells, since they don't have ARID1B, they actually keep ARID1A in there. So this is ARID1B ChIP-seq, ARID1A ChIP-seq. In normal conditions, control lines have ARID1B and do not have ARID1A. But in the patients that don't have ARID1B, ARID1A remains there, binding these enhancers apparently at the day five, when in normal condition, there's not even ARID1A protein. So who's taking care of these enhancers at the IPSC stage though? So you have to know, I didn't mention this, that in iPSC and in embryonic stem cell in general, there is a specific version of BAF called embryonic stem cell BAF that doesn't incorporate ARID1B, but only incorporates ARID1A. And in fact, at the iPSC stage, all the four lines keep ARID1A at these enhancers, likely with the goal of keeping them active and functional, because these are pluripotency enhancers that are important at the iPSC stage. But then when you induce a differentiation, in normal condition, you need to have a switch. ARID1A needs to go away and ARID1B needs to come. And that's what you see in your patient cell, in your control cells. ARID1B is here, ARID1A is gone. But the patient lines show something different. Since you don't have ARID1B, ARID1A sticks around and creates the issue of keeping these enhancers active. And I didn't show for lack of time, but keeping this enhancer active also means that NANOG and SOX2 keep binding at this enhancer when they're not supposed to. And so you have pluripotency enhancers that remain active, remain bound by SOX2 and NANOG, and the nearby genes remain active as well. And in fact, as we've shown by IF, these cells at the day 14, when they're supposed to be nice and form CNCCs, they still have NANOG, they still have OCT4, and so on and so forth. So that's our working model, is that ESBAF is supposed to ensure nucleosome eviction of these enhancers and keeping them open at the IPSC stage. But then when you induce differentiation, you need a switch, you need ARID1B to go there and repress them. And then we also saw that, and we still don't know why, that when the neuroectodermal spheres attach and start making CNCCs, you need to reactivate ARID1A. And we are now trying to understand why. We started this collaboration with Dr. Sam Blackman at Cincinnati Children's Hospital. And our goal is to understand why the CNCCs are upregulating ARID1A. And our hypothesis is maybe because CNCCs needs to still have some level of multipotency to be able to then make all of the possible derivatives and to be able to go mesenchymal, to go ectodermal. And then we think that when you go to the derivative, you commit, ARID1A has to be lost again and ARID1B has to be gained. And so we're working on this model. And with this, I want to thank everyone involved in this project, especially Luca, my postdoc, which is about to leave the lab, but it made a great effort to publish this paper, along with Patrizia and our collaborator, Guy Santen, that gave us a sample. And all of my lab members, my collaborators, the families who donated the samples, my funding here, and my university. And thank you.
Great. Thanks, Marco.
I'll do a stop share.
It's already done.
It's already done. Great.
So we have a few questions. What happens to ARID1B levels or activity during reprogramming? And is there any implication with regards to deriving iPSCs from these patients?
That's a good question. ARID1B, so depending on what you say, at the gene level, ARID1B is always very, very highly expressed also when you reprogram, but the protein level is kept low, probably by some post-transcriptional or post-translational modifications, whereas ARID1A protein level is very high during reprogram. We know that for sure.
Yeah. Do you have an idea how such genetic compensation of ARID1B loss occurs mechanistically?
We also are investigating that with SEM as well. We have two ideas. One is that there are some transcription factors involved in it, and one is that it's actually post-transcriptional as well, meaning that because we see that the gene is always pretty much high expressed, and so it really has to be either through microRNAs that normally inhibit the translation of the protein, or has to be actually even post-translational. We don't know. We're working on this, but it's a great question.
And do 1A and 1B mutually inhibit each other?
No, we don't have any evidence for that. No, I don't think so.
I had a quick question.
Yes.
Are other lineages impacted? So can you differentiate into mesoderm and endoderm, for example?
We haven't tried that yet, but I would assume so. We actually now trying making hippocampal neurons because that's another system we usually work in the lab for other projects. And we are very interested in that because ARID1B is associated with so many neurodevelopmental, like cognitive behavior issues, that there has to be something going on in there as well. And it is also true that the neuroectoderm is not only a precursor of craniofacial formation, it's not only a precursor of neurocrest, but it's especially a precursor of, you know, brain and nervous system formation in general. So we think that this, you know, maybe this could be a unified mechanism. Your neuroectoderm formation specification is not properly working, and so you have impaired craniofacial development and also issues with cognitive and intellectual development.
Oh, great. Well, I want to thank all the speakers. These were great talks,